Martial Arts Hotspots, a journey that will transform mind, body, and spirit. Untie the mysteries of close combat, where hands and feet are mightier than the sword. Where kicking and punching is more than a sport, it's a way of life. In this hour, we'll visit the homes of modern martial arts. The Kung Fu monks of China, testing physical extremes with wills of iron. Powerful Thai kickboxing, where the only way out of the ring is often on a stretcher. The stick fighters of the Philippines, pulling no punches. Korea's army of Taekwondo children. And Japan, where the ancient legends of the samurai are alive and well. China, the longest running civilization on Earth. The remnants of the old rub shoulders with the realities of the new. Armies of terracotta soldiers, a hint of the warrior heritage of this country. Bustling, busy, a billion people crowded together. But China's modern face hides a heritage of conflict and Confucian-style spirituality, the perfect breeding ground for martial arts. Call to prayer, a ritual practiced every day for thousands of years. 500 miles from Beijing is the beginnings of a martial arts story that is to this day a living legend.
The Shaolin Temple is 1,500 years old. It has a great history, and anyone, whether in China or around the world, who studies Kung Fu always want to come to Shaolin.
Like the Vatican is to Catholics, like Mecca is to Muslims, Shaolin Temple is both the physical and temporal home to the monks who have honed and refined the martial art we know as Kung Fu. For these young monks, first lesson of the day is a lesson in combat, drills learnt over and over. This yellow belt novice is allowed to subdue his more experienced comrade. Innocent practice of a deadly and ancient art. This is no game. Concentration and agility are combined to create martial art's great riddle. Why do monks of peace practice war? Warriors of the past stand sentinel over the home of Kung Fu. Ancient tablets telling the story of a fighting tradition. The irony of this Chinese institution is that it was created by an Indian. The monk Bodhidharma traveled to China in the 5th century. Local legend has it he was disgusted with the lazy and slovenly ways of the monks he encountered. So he studied animals and mimicked their movements to create exercises. Shaolin's revered grandmaster himself demonstrates the ancient moves. Exercises perfected by the monks as a form of defense against men and wild animals. Kung Fu literally translates as skill from effort. This high-level display by the Grand Master lost on many of the tourists, unaware of the lineage of this man with an ancient heritage.
The spirituality alone is just wonderful. It's a very, very rich environment for meditation and praying. And this is a really big part of the Chinese culture.
Oh. 9-year-olds wield swords with the confidence of adults. Each monk willing to spend their waking hours studying and practicing the techniques of balance, poise, and strength. A delight for tourists who flock to the spectacle and color of Shaolin, aware that to be treated to these displays by these monks in the ancestral home of Kung Fu is indeed a privilege. Like all martial arts moves, it takes years to perfect. Skilled practitioners make the moves look easy, but beginners soon learn there is more to the kicks and spins than meets the eye. The monk's precision is a skill learned through dedication and training. Kung Fu masters are made, not born.
They're just so concentrated in what they do, and everything's so, it's just awesome the way they do everything. It's just amazing to watch.
Nice to see it in real life by someone who knows what they're doing.
Kung Fu techniques are less about subduing an opponent. Repeated exercises are a form of meditation designed to take the Kung Fu student to a higher level of consciousness. But it's the form of some of these exercises which leave Westerners gaping. This is what Shaolin is most famous for. The extremes of pain and physical torment. The broad concept of bodily punishment is to test the mind, maintaining composure during stressful times. The monks of Shaolin have turned these techniques into a successful show that now tours the world, a commercial spin-off from a grueling training routine. These superhuman skills have at times been rewarded or punished by Chinese dynasties. In the 18th century, these monks would have been killed and their temples burned by an emperor who feared their power. Today, their task is spiritual and commercial. They spend more time impressing tourists than plotting coups. These exercises are not recommended for novices. There is more to them than mind-numbing strength.
Coming to China is a dream, and coming to the source of Kung Fu, Tai Chi, Qigong, fantastic.
It's not just monks drawn to the home of Kung Fu. The lush surrounds of the temple, a fitting location for the graceful movements of Westerners skilled in the art.
Here, use palm sitter, fist sitter. What? What?
Eight. Alan Kelson runs a Tai Chi school in Australia. He's been to Shaolin 4 times already, but says there's always something new to learn.
Shaolin is a great place to come so we can improve our standards, our quality, get accreditation, so we can take the skills back to our countries to present this to our students and lift the quality in our own countries.
A Kung Fu class at schools like the Wushu Institute will cost about $20 a day, which is relatively cheap. Until you consider a Kung Fu master could spend 10 or more years in training. The valley below teems with students who have heard the ancient call of Kung Fu and practice the leaps and twists for which the sport is famous. Unlike the monks who search for a higher spiritual plane, these students are in pursuits of fame and fortune via a high kick. Thousands of students from across China converge on this rural city to unleash their crouching tigers and bask in the glory of an ancient martial art. The valley schools don't always adhere strictly to Kung Fu doctrine. Students are versed in other martial arts, like these kickboxers, to give a well-rounded fighting education. Some use the disciplines of strength and tolerance as skills for their professional lives. Others become martial arts teachers, while others still dream of the Hong Kong martial arts film industry and hope to become kung fu movie stars. Not all who visit Shaolin are interested in developing their fists of fury. Many prefer to give their wallets a workout. The ever-present souvenir stalls cashing in on the Western wonder at this ancient martial art hotspot. Tokyo, the world's biggest city, millions crammed into a metropolis of contrasts and contradiction. Even a society where space is at a premium can allow itself the luxury of extremes, like sumo wrestlers training in one of the city's master academies. But is this a martial art or martial entertainment? While huge men in loincloths grapple with each other, there are Japanese martial arts which cater to the less rotund.
Judo is an exercise as much of the mind as of the body, so you're always looking to get your opponent off his or her balance. You're looking for their weak spots.
Evening falls in Aizu, north of Tokyo, and the home of the samurai. Tonight, a class prepares for the martial art they call the gentle soft way.
Ready? Yo!
A judo master puts the students through its famed wrestling techniques, developed a century and a half ago to test combat skills. Judo developed out of a unique observation. An opponent's strength can be used against him to devastating effect.
Studying martial arts in Japan is a very special experience, particularly here in this city. Which has a very long history of samurai and warriors. We're here in the school that was built to nurture the samurai. So I'm very honored to be able to study here.
This was the first martial art to develop the belt ranking system, white for beginners, then working through the colors to black. A red belt signifies master level. Judo is practiced worldwide, but occasionally a foreign student goes to the heart of judo for some intense one-on-one. Students learn to move efficiently to master judo's explosive power. Brown belt James Kent has spent 2 years working in Japan and spends his leisure time hoping to work his way to a black belt.
Usually there are about 5 or 6 black belts in the class, and they all act as coaches, all act as teachers. Once again, I'm so impressed that they give their time freely to teach the children, to teach the foreigner.
James first came to Japan in 1991 and was hooked on its spiritual way of life. 10 years later, he returned to take up a job in an international association. It gives him the opportunity to absorb every aspect of Japanese culture, in particular, judo. Working with his teacher, or sensei, Tetsuo Ohashi, James practices the moves designed to tip his opponent off balance. Not an easy task given the years of experience he's up against. Finally, with the help of his compliant and understanding coach, James gets the right combination of footwork and thrust. And down goes the sensei. But there's no hard feelings.
Judo is a great workout because it's very physically demanding from the warm-up onwards. But it doesn't just exercise your body, it exercises your mind. So you can really feel like, exhausted after a good session.
Everything has a name in judo. Falls are called ukemi. Tonight, James is getting plenty of ukemi practice. In competitive judo, points are scored by throwing your opponent, each point an ippon. James's ippon count is low, in fact, non-existent.
I'm sorry.
It doesn't hurt as much as it looks to be thrown around, because part of judo is to protect your partner as well as to protect your own body. And so, I mean, the floors are very well sprung, but after 10 or 15 times of being dropped, it starts to take its toll.
Bangkok, Thailand. A city that stimulates every sense. Noisy, bright, colorful, vibrant. This is the hub of Asia, where ideas and cultures merge. Where a martial art was born that is part boxing, part kung fu, and totally explosive. It's not just a sport, it's a national obsession.
Atmosphere is unbelievable. It's just, you know, you hear it walking down the street, you know, like you're within 400 or 500 meters of the place and you can hear the roaring.
Also known as Muay Thai, kickboxing is thought to have come from combat techniques that were brought to Thailand from China centuries ago. It's a powerful, brutal form of combat, famous as the science of eight limbs. Hands, feet, elbows, and knees are all fair game.
If you want to learn Muay Thai, you come to Thailand and learn from the best, the people who actually does Muay Thai, the authentic Muay Thai.
The Fairtech School is the hot spot for kickboxing. Spend a day here, and you'll soon understand you are among some of the world's elite athletes. Training is tough. It's produced 30 world champions under the tutelage of the man known as the Muhammad Ali of Thailand, Apide Sithurin.
It's an honor being taught by him. He's legendary in this country. He walks down the street here and people, you know, respect him and nod to him like they know him, you know.
Australian Chris Logan has come to Asia to learn from the best. It's a grueling regime. A boot camp for fighters with feet of steel. Train here and you join one of Thailand's elite martial arts families.
It's a great camp. They're like a close-knit family. They really take you in as one of their own and they feed you. They ask how things are going, if you're happy with the training.
Thais start young. This child learning to use his limbs as lethal weapons. Making it big in this sport can set you up for life. One of the up-and-coming stars of the school is 16-year-old Tongin Midgerian. His skill is evident. Lightning-fast punches and kicks. He has everything Fairtechs want in their fighters. Focus, superb fitness, stamina, and strength.
If you've been practicing so hard, the weapon that you release just comes naturally, like the kick, the block, the reaction, the reflex, the speed, etc. So he doesn't have to think, like, oh, what am I going to do next?
Tongan readies himself for a fight in Thailand's kickboxing hotspot, Lumphini Stadium.
If he can beat this fight, yes, you know, they prove to everyone that, yeah, he's good enough to be in the pro, and that eventually that his pay raise of the fight price money will go up, and also his competition will go up in ranking. So it would definitely help him out in his career.
The small crowd relished the blood sport to come. Junior boxers spar in the lead up to the main event. The boxers fight for keeps. Scenes like this are not uncommon. Tongan prepares backstage.
We teach him, you know, it's like, you got to be very mentally strong. So you can tell he's very emotionless. So he's focusing on the fight and not focusing on the opponent or anything else. So he's going in with a clean mind, clear mind, so he can be very focused. So to some extent, you can say, yeah, there's a lot of pressure, but don't tell him that.
Spirituality plays a part in kickboxing. Garlands are tied to the body in homage to Buddha. Prayers are offered. The long walk to the stadium begins for Tongan. He's seen it all before and knows the risks. Pre-match warm-ups are a combination of practice and prayer. The boxers focus on the task at hand. The color and the ritual, a relative quiet before the storm of the bout.
He's just gonna go in the first couple rounds, feel the opponent. Since he's relatively new at Lumpini, they don't know his style yet, because he hasn't fought long enough to develop a reputation for being a Mr. Elbow, or the kick, or the fist, or anything like that. So just gonna go with the flow.
Kicks and punches are traded. A few Westerners enjoy the spectacle. Tongan's fight is vicious. Neither gives an inch. Over five grueling three-minute rounds, they trade punches, kicks, and body blows with a determined ferocity. Crowd sense blood. The fight has entered the last round. Tongan's opponent lifts the tempo, landing blow after blow. But victory tonight is not for Tongan. Finished off with knees to the head. A legal move, knocked down in the fifth. A bitter end, but not a setback.
And he's still very young. He's only 16, so he has a lot of fights yet to come and has yet a lot to learn.
His opponent offers comfort, the perfect Buddhist way to end a bloody battle. This is Aizu, home of the famed samurai. Japan's warrior class who spent their lives perfecting not one, but 23 individual martial arts. At the Nishikan Martial Arts Village, the ancient combat of the samurai comes to life. Steeped in tradition, the rituals and lore of the samurai are kept alive by devotees. 21st century inhabitants no longer require these career soldiers to uphold the feudal system of the warlords. Ironically, modern Japanese hand-to-hand martial arts owe their beginnings to laws banning all but the samurai from carrying weapons. The peasants had to learn to deal with overzealous feudal lords with means other than knives. The lessons of the samurai are still alive in the traditions of 21st century martial arts. But an ancient samurai would fall on his sword if he were to time warp to modern Tokyo. Meet Tetsuro Azuma, hairstylist to Tokyo's Hip and Happening. Clients come to his tiny salon from all over Japan, happily paying out hundreds of dollars for the latest do.
This is a bit expensive, but I think for the money, the technique is very good. It's perfect.
Not the image for a martial arts expert? Think again. For this mild-mannered hairdresser shuns the trendy Tokyo nightclubs and explores a different world. Karate. Tonight, Tetsuro has a special treat for his clients. They've joined him at a class with his master, or sensei, Mori-san. Tetsuro acts as a guide on the floor to Mori-san's direction. He allows others to spar with this seventh-degree black belt. Even in Japan, it's hard to find a black belt master at a higher level. Mori-san was once national champion in Japan and practiced his art 6 hours a day, 7 days a week. Now, he simply loves to share all he knows with his students.
He's got a good balance. He tells us that the battle is not with the opponent. The battle's within ourselves. And, it takes a special determination to keep it up.
Australian Matt Reed is only a green belt, but is keen to improve. He believes karate is a great way to stretch his mind and his body.
It's very, very different from when I was studying back home, even though when I was studying back home I had a Japanese master. But over here, as you can see, the ambience is different. You know, you're studying here in the home country. It's totally different.
Karate's roots began centuries ago in the southern Japanese island of Okinawa, where Chinese settlers and Japanese natives combined to create, literally, China hand. This term was modified to empty hand. Karate's use of hands, feet, knees, and elbows to immobilize an opponent became famous in the 1920s. A European boxing champ challenged any comers to knock him down. Only one man took up the challenge, a 51-year-old karate teacher. He knocked the much younger boxer out in one go. Every part of the body is considered a weapon, and if you add the right amount of power at a high speed, it's a deadly repertoire.
The point of this martial art is to basically end a confrontation with one blow. So basically, if you think of it in those terms, it would look very aggressive, I believe, from your point of view.
This view is taken from a specially mounted camera. It gives an idea of what it's like to be on the other side of a karate opponent. Fists flying, kicks landing on your head. No place for the faint-hearted. On the other side of Tokyo is karate's premier school. And while recognizing the art has a spiritual element, this class knows what makes karate different from other martial arts. Here, opponents are known as the enemy, and students are told they must play to win. The key is to outsmart your opponents physically and mentally, and hope you never have to use your martial arts skills outside a class or tournament.
if someone were to, for example, attack you, you would like to end this confrontation in the best way possible. Might be running away, or if you can't get away, then it would be to finish the fight.
Californian Dan Cook shunned regular sports as a child. Karate became his thing. He became a second-degree black belt in the U.S., but then he moved to Japan.
So it felt as if I was moving underwater, and everybody else was moving within in the air, flying. So it was very different. I've learned so much in the years that I've been here.
He had to become faster, stronger, and relearn the martial art he'd already spent years studying.
Basically, the focus is much more on speed. So what's much more exciting here is that we move much more quickly than we did back in the United States.
It's been a decade, and Japan is now his home. For this expat American, Oriental martial arts is now a way of life.
I think Tokyo is a wonderful place to live. The things that I thought were exotic about karate, for example, bowing, are not exotic here. They're basically just normal. It's part of the culture.
Traditional folk dancing in South Korea, a rare peek into a world almost forgotten in the drive to modernize. Sandwiched between mainland China and the islands of Japan, Korea was invaded time and again, but managed to keep enough of its culture intact by closing itself off from the world for 300 years. Now, it's a country divided. Seoul, a vibrant capital of one of Asia's strongest tigers, and home to one of the great martial arts, Taekwondo.
So we exercise and we learn to defend ourselves, and it's a way of thinking and living. So it's a sport, but it's more than that. There's a philosophy that goes with it.
Few martial arts can boast being turned into a musical. But Show Taekwon has managed to turn a fighting technique thousands of years old into an energetic stage show that features everything this martial art is all about. Strength, agility, flying, spinning, showing off the high, powerful kicks that Taekwondo is famous for. Performing on stage is one thing, but it's the practice behind the performance which makes this martial art dynamic. Children as young as six train at Seoul's premier Taekwondo school, the Midong Elementary. They're treading in the footsteps of an art developed 2,000 years ago, combining Chinese martial arts with Mongolian combat and Korean kicking. Taekwondo translates roughly as foot-hand way, aptly describing the skills needed to master it. Breaking wood is a favorite technique, showing the skill and dexterity needed to become a master. At international exhibitions, it's not uncommon for 15 roof tiles to be smashed with a single punch. These gladiators in the making are skilled at going head to head, combining an impressive array of high kicks with blocks and parries. three-on-one defense keeps the youngsters on their toes. The constant calling of I serving two purposes, to put off your opponent and verbalize your inner strength as you deliver the kicks and punches. Jackie Chan himself would marvel at the skill shown by these Taekwondo tots.
Kick, then switch side.
Like all martial arts, going to the source is the best way to learn. Foreigners making the trek to Seoul aren't disappointed. Seventh degree black belt master Kim Jung-sun takes the class through its paces. An eye-opener for those who studied in their home countries, only to discover the true path in Korea.
Hip joint, use your hip joint wider, wider. She's the ping.
Kim's students have traveled from Japan, Germany, and North America to train in the heart of Seoul. Some have spent years studying Taekwondo. Others are newcomers to the technique. All believe they've something new to learn in the country where it all started.
You get the pure, untainted style and just learning the martial art itself from the source, it's always a good thing.
Kevin Sung grew up in Los Angeles. The son of Korean immigrants, he did a little Taekwondo as a child, but he got a fright when he took up the martial art again in the country of his ancestors.
Oh, I couldn't walk for about a month.
Okay, good. Longer the better. Bang, legs.
Connie Newman studied Taekwondo for 8 years in Germany before she came here. A serious competitor back home, she had an eye on an Olympic medal. She came to Seoul to sharpen her skills, but was shocked at the difference.
Do it nothing or they do it 100%. There's nothing between. So in Germany, you can do Taekwondo a little bit and a little bit more. But in Korea, you do or you not do.
Connie was in with a chance of winning gold. Koreans may dominate the sport, but the world's first ever Taekwondo medal was won by an American. Stunning beaches, balmy temperatures, and enough sun to take the sting out of your stress. Welcome to Cebu, a hop, skip, and jump away from Manila in the heart of the Philippines. Coconut cocktail, anyone? Sun lovers come here from all over the world to chill out, kick back, and top up their tan. And for a select few, discover a unique and deadly martial art. Long before Bruce Lee made an art of fending off multiple attackers, the practitioners of Eskrima were twisting and turning with sticks and knives. Unusually, this Filipino martial art teaches you how to use weapons first and fists later.
You don't really have the time to think about being hit, really. You're more thinking about delivering your own blows and getting to the other guy before he gets to you.
Our special martial arts camera gives you an idea of how fast Eskrima is. When you're this close, every move is dangerous. Sticks fly until your opponent is disarmed and subdued. For 2,000 years, Filipino warriors have been perfecting this art of fencing. But it came to the fore in 1521 in an historic battle against the invading Spanish. Vastly outnumbered, warrior Lapu-Lapu killed the sword-wielding Spanish explorer Ferdinand Magellan, and Eskrima became a symbol of independence, the Spanish outlawing it for 300 years.
We have stick fighting, we have knife fighting, there is blade fighting, punch and kick. We have a form of grappling and takedowns. So it is a very comprehensive, it is a very complete martial art.
Okay, done.
Joni Cañete is one of the few Escrima grandmasters. His school attracts students from around the world. The Philippines' best grandmasters have gathered for a special display. Grandmaster Maranga shows a novice a thing or two about stick-to-stick combat.
We don't only teach them the martial art, but also to build, develop good discipline and character. That is what is very important, because that is what is this country needs if this country wants to be great again.
At 64, Cañete is still strong and agile. His opponents may be a third his age, but age is not a factor.
Age doesn't matter. The older you grow, you become, the more you become wiser. And perhaps it's only the reflexes that is affected a little bit. Strike, 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 strike. Curve, it's curving, right? This is a flicking or snap wrist. Strike, yeah?
His speed is phenomenal. And his breadth of techniques as well is incredible, really, that he knows so much of empty-handed, with sticks, with dagger, different combinations. You know, it would take a lifetime to get to the level that he's at, I think.
It's the knife work which sets Escrima apart from other martial arts. The grandmaster spars with his prize student and nephew, four-time national champion Val Pableo. This is the defense posture to ward off a knife attack, a mixture of blocking and counter-defense practiced over and over.
Now this is what you do. When you start, you block, you counter, low, slide up. When he goes up to block, you check his defense, wrangling your wrist, cut his neck, cut his right side, and stop.
The theory goes, if you can master sticks and knives, unarmed combat will come naturally. Like most martial arts, Escrima is used for defense, not attack.
I've used it before when I used to work in a nightclub, and someone tried to hit me in the face with a glass, and fortunately I was able to disarm him, so martial arts did help me.
Scott Slezak is one of the many foreigners in the Philippines to learn from the grandmaster. He and Englishman Mike Flynn have come to Cañete's school to fine-tune their techniques.
I like the practical nature of it, really. It's very easy from starting out to see the more obvious practical applications, rather than having to study and train and train and train before really you can see this is going to work for you.
The real Escrima action takes place away from the school and in the tournaments organized at a local shopping mall. Drawing a crowd of onlookers, senior practitioners demonstrate the correct techniques. Then the competition begins proper. And it's not just the men who are in the thick of things. Scott is the only foreigner competing today. It may look unconventional, but each bout is timed, and the judges score according to the number of blows landed. It's an intense contest. Neither fighter can afford to slow down, or his opponent will gain the upper hand. This is Scott's moment of truth. A win means his trip to the Philippines has been worthwhile.
I feel good because I train hard. It's always worth the pain. Hard work pays off.
A grandmaster invites students to a challenge. He tempts them to throw him. Time and again, they fail. This grandmaster is a living legend, the grandson of a man who developed his own martial art. Japan is a country of contradictions. Its cities embrace the future. But its countryside clings to the proud traditions and ceremony of the past. Americans Doug Williams and Chris Valpiani have chosen the latter, shunning technology, for a walk on the spiritual side.
I want one green pig.
Doug Williams spends his working day teaching first graders the finer points of English.
One green pig and one pink rabbit. So, ina, hi, ina, hi. Okay. Good. Hey, good job. You know, good job, good job.
Yeah, we'll just review the...
But his relationship with the school is much more than a professional one. His supervisor plays a very special role in Doug's martial art life. Doug's school supervisor reemerges as his Aikido master, Sakai-san. Aikido is neither a sport nor a martial art. It actually means way of harmony and is all about deflecting conflict by sending energy back on your opponent. It's renowned for its circular, harmonious movement, which disguises the actual force behind it.
I mean, being here would be like maybe studying classical music in Austria. You've got the history there. You've got the atmosphere behind you.
The Americans have over 720 Aikido techniques to learn, but physical moves are only part of Aikido's repertoire. Its spiritual aim is to bring inner peace and harmony by focusing on the simplicity of Aikido's moves.
The reason I'm here studying Aikido was because I met Sakai Sensei at a bar, and he pretty much made me cry by manipulating my pinky, and I thought that was just the greatest thing.
Size is irrelevant in this martial art.
My teacher laughs at me quite a bit because of my inexperience. I end up on the ground a lot, and I end up pulling them on the ground a lot, but it's a great time.
But the ultra-modern facade of Tokyo can cope with Aikido's harmony.
Hello, konnichiwa. How are you?
A different group of expats meets for coffee. This innocent start to the day lies in stark contrast to events later at the international home of Aikido. Coffee time chat is forgotten, for these students are developing their inner strength through outer exertion.
You're not using your strength to overpower your opponent. A lot of the technique is executed through a Japanese concept. It's called taisabaki, which is body positioning.
Former Los Angeles lawyer William Gillespie shocked friends and family when he threw in his high-paying legal job and moved to Japan to learn Aikido from the masters. His friends now join him in daily workouts, trading sweat and blows.
In Aikido, there are more women than other martial arts. Maybe that's because of the harmonious atmosphere and soft movements, and also because physical strength is not the point. There's no winning and no losing.
Thank you.
I really love the idea that you, for 1 hour every day, you can completely focus your mind and your body on one thing only. And it's just that ideal amount of discipline which I really love.
Aikido was developed by Morihei Ueshiba in 1925. At the age of 80, he could still pin an opponent to the ground with his finger. Today, the family tradition is kept alive by his grandson, Moriteru. He says he was born into it. He has a special treat for the students, a rare demonstration of the skills he learned from the moment he could walk. His secret is Aikido's higher state of awareness. Moriteru can sense and preempt an attack before his opponent is upon him. The gentler movements hiding a force that has disarmed exponents of other martial arts.
It's magical. There's no other word to describe it other than it's just, you come in here and you have an hour of these amazing teachers who really, I suppose, like national treasures in Japan.
Martial Arts Hotspots, the spiritual and physical homes of the modern-day gladiators of the fighting sports, where discipline, strength, and agility combine, revealing themselves to the world.